Today I will speak a little bit about my own personal approach to the Pipa. When we made this project and we knew that we will have our guests from Taiwan, the first thing I did, I was to order a Pipa from Amazon.
他接触琵琶的一些看法还有印象。那当他开始要做这个计划的时候，他第一件事情就是从网站 Amazon， 就是有中文吗？亚马逊还是什么？就是大家应该知道嘛，就是购物那个网站，订购了一把琵琶。Because
it's not easy to buy a pipa in Austria. You can buy easily a piano or a violin, but the pipa you won't find.
因为我们知道在这个奥地利没有办法买到琵琶，所以他就上网网购。And
when this instrument arrived a few weeks after, it turned out that it was a good instrument, and I couldn't play anything with it.
那过了几个礼拜以后，这个新的琵琶到了，他发现其实是一个很不错的乐器，就是这把大概很不错，可是呢，他不知道该怎么样来弹，怎么样来用这样子一个乐器。Although
I have some experience as a guitar player, which I was in my youth time, it was impossible to play on the pipa because it's so different. So I tried to find a different approach. Not seeing the pipa as a different type of lute or guitar, but as a very interesting percussion instrument.
虽然他年轻的时候曾经玩过吉他，但是呢，他拿到琵琶以后，发现这个其实是一个很不一样的乐器，那他就从一个不同的角度来，这个出发，他不是用一种怎么样来弹琵琶。 或者研究琵琶的有什么样的技巧啊？因为他也无从学起，所以呢，他就把琵琶视为一种打击乐器来处理。So
the pipa has a very nice resonance board with a lot of sound on it. So in order to capture the sounds and get more into the details, I put a special contact microphone on top of the resonance board.
那他发现其实琵琶的共鸣的那种音响其实很不错，那他就是特别还用了一个小的一个麦克风把它放在那个琵琶的面板上面。And
then I was able to get into the little details, not only by hitting and tapping the instrument, but also by scratching and tapping and caressing the body and the strings, and producing a variety of interesting sounds which were only audible if you amplify them.
所以呢，他刚刚我们说把琵琶当作一个敲击乐器，但是他的方式并不是说只是在琵琶的各个部门去敲啊拍啊，其实我们一些中国的琵琶曲也有，而是说他用一些，比方用摩擦抚摸在琵琶不同的部位。 那所以这也为什么它必须要有一个麦克风，因为那些声响，其实很细微的，如果不经过扩音的话，观众是听不到的。And
then it turned out that the resonances of the strings produces a very dominant tonal spectrum.
那因为在这个琵琶的弦上面，经过它这样子一种新的手法的去。 弹奏姑且说，那他发现其实琵琶的这个发声的一些共鸣，是非常非常有趣的。So
the first thing what I did was to make a little detuning of the instrument. Instead of the A D E A tuning, I tuned the lower string up to B flat.
所以呢，它也不是用一般琵琶标准的定弦，那四根弦，而是把这个最低的那个老弦，好像提高了半音，是 B flat， 就降 B。
And by this little adjustment, the sound of the pipa immediately changed completely from a pentatonic spectrum to a, I would say, atonal.
所以呢，经过这样子一个细，只是差了一个半音，他们发现，这个琵琶的 定弦就已经不是五声音阶啊，而是一个进步到变成一个无调性的感觉。
Then we had the workshop with our Taiwanese guests in December, and Hui Quan Lin introduced us to the history and the playing techniques of the instrument.
那去年十二月的时候，林慧宽老师到了维也纳，就给他们做了一个琵琶的工作坊啊，介绍了琵琶的历史，还有它音乐，还有它的美学。
And by this, I learned a lot about the background and the history of this instrument. And my first very naive approach changed towards another one, where I tried to understand the meaning and the stories which these instruments tells from your culture.
好，那有了这样子进一步的接触以后，他从原先完全不懂，很天真的手法去处理琵琶啊，因为他现在经过那个新奇的这个工作坊，他对琵琶比较有了认识，而且他背后的一些文化历史啊，所以呢，他又有一些新的想法，怎么样来写他的这个琵琶曲。
And by speaking with Hui Quan Lin about this instrument, I asked her frankly, I guess there must be something written about the pipa by one of your famous poets.
You mean the poem?
Yes.
Oh,
I will speak about it afterwards.
Oh, okay. 那他就问林慧宽老师啊，关于一首关于琵琶很有名的诗，我在猜想是不是就是《琵琶行》啊？他底下会说。
But I didn't know about the pipa poem, which is the next thing I want to tell you, of Bai Juyi from the 9th century Tang Dynasty, and she told me, yes, there is this very important pipa tune, and I asked her, ah, it's great that you tell me this.Can you tell me this tune? And he said, No, I don't know it by heart, but we find it on the internet.
Oh, okay. 就是没错，就是白居易的那首诗《琵琶行》啊。但是excuse me, you mean the poem or the music?
No, the
poem.
The poem.
白居易。Yes. 所以他就在网络上面就搜寻了这个《琵琶行》的这首诗。
And then there was another Taiwanese musician, and she had a mobile phone, and she immediately found the text of the poem. And I asked Hui Quan to speak a few lines from this poem, which are especially speaking about the pipa.
Oh, so he, 他那时候就用那个一个台湾朋友，然后用那个智慧手机马上上网，就找到了这首诗，然后。那 Professor Essl 他就要求林慧宽老师，就是因为那诗很长嘛，就是选了几段立即的翻译给他听。
And I made a recording of her voice, only 5 lines of the poem, and used this afterwards also in my composition as a material.
了解了，就是他请那个林慧宽老师，可能不是翻译了，而是说念给他听，念了五行。然后呢，他就把林慧宽老师念这首白居易的《琵琶行》的诗啊的一部分录下来，然后把这样子一个吟诗或者朗诵诗的音响运用在他的这个电子音乐里面，或者是他的一个作品里面。
And when I began to start composing the piece in the beginning of 2015, I read the whole poem, and in the first verse, there is a wonderful image that is shown.
然后他在今年初开始要写这首作品的时候，那他就是先从白居易《琵琶行》的第一句，浔阳江头夜送客，我还可以背，那他就说，哇，这个是一个很有气氛的，很有那种氛围，很漂亮的一个那种感觉。
So he speaks about a night scene at the river where the high moon is standing.And the light of the moon is reflecting on the river, and from the far you hear the sound of a pipa, and there is autumn, and the leaves are falling from the trees.
他就在叙述这个很诗情画意的，有在一个夜晚江头，然后月亮的照映，然后呢，从远处传来了琵琶的声音。
So and when I heard, the words autumn leaves, moonlight.Two pieces of music immediately came into my mind, very famous songs or pieces of music, The one is Autumn Leaves, an old jazz standard, which maybe you all know. And the other one is not less unknown. It's the Moonlight Sonata of Beethoven.
Oh. 然后呢，他就联想到两首曲子，一首是一个很有名的爵士乐，就叫秋叶，翻译成中文 Autumn Leaves， 秋叶，秋天的叶子。然后另外一个呢，就是贝多芬的月光嘛，那就是贝多芬的月光奏鸣曲。
And by these ingredients, is pipa is a percussion instrument. The pipa as an instrument with a tradition connected to a poem by Wei Yu Yi and electronics.I created a piece where I also tried to melt in Autumn Leaves and Moonlight Sonata, but this you will hear tomorrow.
Oh, okay. The day after
the day?
Friday.
I have no feeling of time. I'm completely out of this.
Okay. 可是这首曲子是要礼拜五的在松烟才演的，所以大家听了刚刚铺陈了这么久，不是等一下下面那一首，而是礼拜五晚上的在松烟的曲目，那他呢就是把琵琶当作一个敲击乐器，加上爵士乐，加上贝多芬的这个月光奏鸣曲，还有 Professor Essl 他的电子音乐，这些完全不同的元素，看他怎么样把它融合在一起。
And to finish my little talk, I want to tell you that it was very important for me to play the pipa afterwards. After having learned all the playing techniques, I was, when composing the piece, tried out everything on the instrument before I wrote it down.
就是他在作曲的过程中，虽然他先前从完全不了解到慢慢在摸索，那他这个曲子就是初步写出来以后，他作为一个作曲家，还是他会在琵琶上面抱起琵琶，把所有他写的音都在上面试过，才了解实际的出来的音响是怎么样。